Doug, stand-up physicist. And today I'm going to discuss repair work I did to a wall hanging I have in my basement that shows my own perspective on number theory. And it's different from the standard sorts of approaches in a way that I hope gives us new insights to how nature does her amazing work. Now, most centers for theoretical physics will have, you know, quotes on the wall by Einstein and Bohr, Newton, Feynman perhaps, and they will have a very expensive cappuccino machine. Now, here in my basement, we're not kind of that highbrow. This repair work required a glue gun and some pipe cleaners. Is this deep stuff? I hope so. Okay, so what we're going to do first is have a look at the real numbers, which are used everywhere in physics, and the complex numbers, which are also used everywhere in physics, and other things on the side. We'll get to those later. The first row is the topology of addition. The middle row is the graph theory for multiplication. And the final row is my effort to make numbers necessarily dynamic. I know, we're taught, you don't look at our fingers, but then those fingers had to be show up. So I'm struggling with how to make numbers dynamic inherently. Okay, so let's just start with the simplest thing, which is the real numbers and addition. So what I had a few days ago up on the wall was kind of what people expect to see, which is a real number line that goes like this. And zero sits in the middle. That's certainly what I was taught. But I started to get bothered by something. And that is that there are these two sets. Now, we call one positive and the other negative, but they really are the same thing. And their relationship is that they're connected to zero. But what happens if you say, go out 5? Well, that's easy. You go to zero and you go out 5. So we just had this sort of pipe cleaner model, and you say, well, that's all that is. It's no big deal. But what if we went out like here? Let's say this was 6, and the negative was 1. Well, 6 minus 1 is 5. Oh, that's still true. And we could go out here to 7 and 2, and you go, I think I see the pattern. As a matter of fact, there are an infinite number of possible 5s. And you might say, yeah, well, I really prefer a world where there's just 1, okay? Well, that might be your preference, and it certainly has been my preference, but that doesn't mean that's nature's preference. She might just really like a lot of redundancy to say, how many different ways can you say 5? And what if I say 5 an odd way many, 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 many times, and I don't say 5 a different way that I could have said? To me, this opens up possibilities for how nature might work. But the rules are universal, in a sense, that if you decide to work, say, with one of the sets, and you add it to another member of that set, well, you just add it. Now, if you're looking at the difference between the two, then go ahead and take the difference. And then, whosoever is bigger, they win. And when I was doing this, of course I could have used minus signs, because everybody does that. But I was thinking just one step ahead. I was thinking about these things called complex numbers, where I squared equaled minus 1. So I said, why not use that? And in fact, that's what I did. So that's my view about real number addition, really emphasizing those two sets and their relationship to each other. Then I started to think about the multiplication. And it's like, well, I was taught those rules, right? Well, yeah, I was too. Same rules. A positive times a positive is positive. A negative times a negative is positive. And if you get a mix, then you end up being the negative thing. Well, it turns out that has a formal name. That's the abelian cyclic group, Z2. And it's like, that's part of where the tension arose for me. It's like, why are there that two part? What's the two-ness? I mean, because I've been taught about the real numbers as being this just thing, and you just go somewhere on the line, and you got this one number. And that's when I started thinking about, well, it really is two sets. And so it makes sense that we need this group Z2 to tell us about the relationship between the two sets. It's not complicated, okay? It's not hard. But I'm thinking about things a little bit differently. And it was a lot of fun drawing the thing for the graph for zero. The graph for zero has all these little clover leaves on them. Well, why? Well, here, maybe you don't know graph theory. Graph theory is you start at a vertex, you go on a pipe cleaner, an edge, and you come back to a vertex. So zero times, well, anything is going to get zero. So zero times zero is zero, and zero times one is zero, and zero times I squared is zero. And then I had the Z2 group, which is this wonderful, you know, gray square and white square, and the direction between, I mean, the way to go from minus one to positive one is with a gray pipe cleaner. And it actually works the other way too. In other words, if you start with one and you multiply by the gray pipe cleaner, you end up at minus one. And they both have these white ears, as it were, because whatever the number is, times one gets you the number back. And that was all well and good until I realized I'm missing something. I'm literally missing something. And that's these black things that go from the white square to or gray square to zero. And those are directional. Okay, by that I mean 1 times 0 is 0. Mm-hmm. Okay, but how about the other way? Is 0 times 0 equal to 1? It's like, no. Okay, so to do that, I put a little bead on it to say, you know, I'm going this way from the white one to 0. And the same for the negative guy, the I squared guy, he also has to have a beaded 0. In order to just go that way. And so that was my fix. But what about that bottom row? Okay, that is my animation of real numbers. And I'm doing this kind of in a discrete way. So if it's zero, there's like nothing there. If there's a one, well, you see the white block. And it can be in the past, the now, or the future. So how many possibilities are there? Well, there are only 8, okay? Because that is 2 to the 3rd. So now when we go to think about complex numbers, it's like nearly the same story. The only difference is that we add more sets. So while we used to have just 2 sets, we now have 4 sets. Or more formally, real numbers and imaginary numbers. And here again, I'm opting for putting them right next to each other so that if I think of a delta, it makes more sense. You know, if I don't have the delta, then 100 and 105, that difference is that's just 5. But if I go like this, it's like, that hurts. And when I go to 1,000,000,006, That I don't want to do a billion and one the other direction. Whereas, you know, oh, I don't really care. I'm going to get the delta. You see, because one of the deepest ideas in the tradition of mathematical physics is known as a mathematical field. And you can add things and you can multiply things. Now, why do you do that?
Well,
you study the book. This is Principles of Mathematical Analysis. This is the logical foundations of calculus. I go, whoa, that's got to be heavy stuff. And it relies on this properties of a mathematical field. And I'm not going to read the definition. It's kind of boring. Okay? But when you think about how that's the formal definition of a derivative, it doesn't involve addition. It doesn't involve multiplication. It involves the inverse of addition, subtraction, and it involves the inverse of multiplication, division by your little delta thingy, and you're saying that that all goes to zero. So I now think of this as like, wow, that's kind of cool that it's always using the inverse operations to define the study of change, as I like to call calculus. Okay, so the rules for addition, well, they're just the same as I went over before. If you're kind of the same, except that now instead of, well, I squared, what would I have? I'd have I squared, I cubed, and how about I to the fourth? Oh, then that's when you get into modulo calculus and say modulo 4. So I to the 0 is the same as I to the 4. I to the 5th is going to be the same as I to the 1, okay? And if they are and now you're like totally cool with what if it's I to the 3/2 power? It's like no biggie. You know, you just crank through it and it'll work out. It won't be this super neat, I'm all imaginary and I'm all real situation anymore. It mixes it up. But we're supposed to be theoretical physicists. We're supposed to be cool with mixing it numbers up like that. Okay, so the rules, as I say, same. You add, if you're adding like things, like an I to another I, just add it up. If you're now adding together things that are kind of differ by exactly a factor of 2, so an I and an I cubed, that means that you must figure out the difference and who is bigger, because whoever's bigger wins. Now we go on to the rules of multiplication, and you go, well, I could count 4 different sorts of those little straw thingies. So that must mean we're dealing with a set of 4, and that, in fact, is the cyclic group Z4. And it makes this nice square, and we have, going around that square, directional edges. Why'd you do that? Well, if you want to go from 1 to I, you multiply by I. Well, that's easy enough. But what if you want to go the other way? Well, you go I times minus I, and you'll get back to 1. So that's where all those directional edges are needed. And of course, they still have all the little ears, little ones, times any of those 4 factors gets you right back to there. 0 looks like more fun. It's got more hoops around it. And the upgrade that I had to do was now to put in all the directional edges from the various I's to 0. Can't go back. Only can go to 0. It's like this black hole. It just sucks everything up. Do I understand what that really means? No. Not at this point. But, hey, plenty more to think about. And now, when we go to animated, well, there's now a kind of left, a middle, and a right. And there are more possibilities here. In fact, it's you get 2 to the 3 times 3, 2 to the 9th. That's 512 different possibilities. So that's quite a bit bigger just going to complex numbers. So today, physics is done over these two mathematical fields. Classical physics can almost all be done with real numbers, and quantum mechanics definitely requires the complex numbers for quantum wave interference and other things like that. But why did I say over a mathematical field? Why didn't I say they just use them? Well, because it should be kind of obvious. You can't even do classical physics with either of these out of the box. In other words, if you got something like fidget spinner and it goes boosh, it's like, well, you've got 3 dimensions of space and time, and you don't have that many slots. You're not going to be able to just deal with the space part. So what, and believe me, physicists totally know how to handle a fidget spinner. They would say, I'm going to make a 3-dimensional vector space, and then I'm going to add an exterior algebra in order to get the, you know, cross product thing going on. And then I'm going to bring in these conservation laws, and then I'm going to be able to describe it absolutely perfectly fine, which is what they can do. But I would like a type of number where I don't have to, like, add, like, anything, like, ever. Can we find such a number? Well, I think it's possible. And as a matter of fact, I've thought so for quite a long period of time. And so that is the final panel in this wall hanging that, yes, needed the same kinds of fixes as the other ones. But you go, wonder what he did. I know, he just added more sets. Exactly, okay. So I added 4 more sets. I had 4, added 4. I got now 8 sets. And we've got the X, the Y, the Z, and time. And we're thinking about the positive time, negative time. That would be past and future. We're thinking about left and versus right, we're talking up versus down, we're thinking, but we're putting them right next to each other so that we can do that delta trick and not be worried about how near or far we are to whatever somebody called the origin. Now the multiplication, now that gets pretty insane. I mean, now we've got this cube, okay, and I actually write out the whole multiplication table. Well, it's actually the one that we saw in the complex numbers, it's Z4, in triplicate. Oh, except that 3 of them are exactly the same. So, like, eliminate 2 rows, eliminate 2 columns, and you get the Q8, or quaternion group multiplication table. And I really, really love the 0 there. I mean, it looks like a tarantula. I mean, how many wires gotta go dive in and out of that thing? And then I had to, you know, get my Dremel and drill little holes and figure out how to, you know, connect all of those 8 types of factors to back to 0 and fit it in there and not have it fall apart. So that's also pretty great. And of course there's the animation, and the thing that really gets crazy is, you know, when you have an up down, a near far, a left right, that means you got a cube that's got 27 spots. So since you can either have something there or not have something there, that means you've got a total possibility of 2, to the 3 times 27, 2 to the 81, which is 2.4 times 10 to the 24th. And you go, well, that's... I'm just making discrete films here, okay? It's like, that's really stupidly large. But that's the way numbers in nature appear to be. You know, you'll say, well, there's a mole of stuff in this microphone, which means there's 10 to the 23rd kind of atoms in it. And numbers that are super huge are part of physics. Is it possible to be reductionist? You know, because physicists and scientists in general love the reductionist type of approach. Can we make something that's actually simpler than the real numbers? And then analyze it in terms of addition, in terms of multiplication, and film. Okay, so there would be only one set. And if we're going to do addition, well, as I recall, 0 plus 0 equals 0. So that works. And how about 1 plus 1 equals 2? Okay, so that doesn't quite work. So that's not going to be included in this reductionist approach. Now let's think about the graph for multiplication. All right, well, we know 0 times 0 is 0. Ah, but it's also true that 1 times 1 equals 1. So which one's right? Oh no, they're both fine. They're both perfect. And in fact, it's a little strange that there are these two, because they don't have the same kind of quality. You know, if you just took all the other numbers and multiplied them by 0, oh, that would always get you back to 0. If you start at 0 times any other number, you never leave. But with unity, well, 1 times 9 is 9, okay. So you could kind of like expand once you had 1. You can't expand the possibilities with 0, because 0 is just this black hole of numbers. Whereas unity, well, that can work. Actually, you can make a group with it, because say 9 times a ninth gives you 1. And so you can just expand forever with unity. So that's very different. Okay, how about film? Well, there's only going to be one frame. You go, that's kind of like that film of the Empire State Building, that was 8 hours of the same thing, only this would go back to the beginning of the universe. That sounds kind of silly. Unless it's not. What could that actually be? And my thought on this is that is here now. Now, I consider myself the center of the universe. And because I'm the center of the universe, I'm at 0, 0, 0, 0. Cool. Now, I'm cool with you actually thinking of yourself as the center of the universe, 0, 0, 0, 0. And now we have a question. How is it that you get to the next moment of your own life? Now, as a mathematical physicist type, I actually had to provide you an equation, an expression for how you achieve that really easy to achieve goal. Because not only does it work for you and for me, it also works for empty space. You know, there's an empty space right next to my head, and it seems to be there. In the next moment of our lives. It's like, how do we all do this? And so my thought on this subject is that 0, 0, 0, 0 plus 0, 0, 0, 0 gets you back to 0, 0, 0, 0. So this sounds kind of trivial. As a matter of fact, in that multiplication step that we have there, it's called the trivial group. And people think it's trivial because of its name. but I don't actually think it's trivial, like, at all. I mean, this is a core question in physics. How is it things continue to exist? They don't seem to put any energy into it. And that could be answered by the equation of 0 plus 0 equals 0. Because there is no energy involved. It just happens. Which appears to be how life, in fact, and non-life, like this area next to my head, also keeps on existing. So the trivial group actually may be a little bit more interesting than people give it credit for. All right, thank you very much. Is it possible to be reductionist? You know, because physicists and scientists in general love the reductionist type of approach. Can we make something that's actually simpler than the real numbers? And then analyze it in terms of addition, in terms of multiplication, and film. Okay, so there would be only one set. And if we're going to do addition, well, as I recall, 0 plus 0 equals 0. So that works.
I'm going to freeze the video for just a moment and address the question of, what should I call these numbers? Well, binary numbers would be 0 and 1. And it's not quite that. It's more 0 or 1, along with the idea of the superposition of 0 and 1, because that is fundamental to so much of quantum mechanics. So there's not quite a right name. Unary numbers are already taken for those little check marks you make, you know, to count up to 5 or 10. So it's a slightly different notion because it's not just 0 or 1, but their relationship to each other.
And how about 1 plus 1 equals 2? Okay, so that doesn't quite work. So that's not going to be included in this reductionist approach. Now let's think about the graph for multiplication. All right, well, we know 0 times 0 is 0. But it's also true that 1 times 1 equals 1. So which one's right? Oh no, they're both fine. They're both perfect. And in fact, it's a little strange that there are these two, because they don't have the same kind of quality. You know, if you just took all the other numbers and multiplied them by 0, oh, that would always get you back to 0. If you start at 0 times any other number, you never leave. But with unity, well, 1 times 9 is 9. Okay. So you could kind of like expand once you had 1. You can't expand the possibilities with 0, because 0 is just this black hole of numbers. Whereas unity, well, that can work. Actually, you can make a group with it, because say 9 times a ninth gives you 1. And so you can just expand forever with unity. So that's very different. Okay, how about film? Well, there's only going to be one frame. You go, that's kind of like that film of the Empire State Building, that was 8 hours of the same thing, only this would go back to the beginning of the universe. That sounds kind of silly. Unless it's not. What could that actually be? And my thought on this is that is here now. Now, I consider myself the center of the universe. And because I'm the center of the universe, I'm at 0, 0, 0, 0. Cool. Now, I'm cool with you actually thinking of yourself as the center of the universe, 0, 0, 0, 0. And now we have a question. How is it that you get to the next moment of your own life? Now, as a mathematical physicist type, I actually had to provide you an equation, an expression for how you achieve that really easy to achieve goal. Because not only does it work for you and for me, it also works for empty space. You know, there's an empty space right next to my head, and it seems to be there in the next moment of our lives. It's like, how do we all do this? And so my thought on this subject is that 0000 plus 0000 gets you back to 0000. So this sounds kind of trivial. As a matter of fact, in that multiplication step that we have there, it's called the trivial group. And people think it's trivial because of its name. But I don't actually think it's trivial like at all. I mean, this is a core question in physics. How is it things continue to exist? They don't seem to put any energy into it. And that could be answered by the equation of 0 plus 0 equals 0. Because there is no energy involved. It just happens. Which appears to be how life, in fact, and non-life, like this area next to my head, also keeps on existing. So the trivial group actually may be a little bit more interesting than people give it credit for. All right, thank you very much. Now, I usually don't add anything personal because I do theoretical physics, and it's not the most personal story kind of activity. I'm going to make an exception here because this video was about this improvement I made to this representation of number theory, and I had some insights into how do I continue to live my life. And I did a wrap on that on July 16th. And on July 17th, they did open heart surgery on me to replace a heart valve that has been bad since I was born. I had just two leaflets, and now I've got this bovine one that's got three. And I can tell you the bottom line is it was a clear upgrade. I can walk more than 10,000 steps in a day. I'm not needing to go take a nap or no chest pains. It was really all a positive sort of thing. But of course, when you're going in for that sort of operation, you just wonder whether, like me, would I continue? And, well, I realized that my hydrogen atoms, which are some 13 billion years old, born in the Big Bang, that would have continued on just fine. And so would have my oxygen and phosphorus and little manganese and iron. Actually, I don't know how many higher order sort of atoms make up the human body, but there's certainly a lot of them. And those were born in the supernova sometime after the Big Bang. And so somewhere between, say, 10 and 4 billion years ago, all those atoms, they would have been just fine. It's the brain that my brain would have been, okay. So how do I deal with that idea that maybe I couldn't have presented this idea? Well, it really comes down to two cases. In the first case, this idea just has no lasting value. Yes, it's possible. In fact, some could argue it's probable. And if that's the case, it's no big deal that I didn't get to put in the weak effort it took to do all the post-production stuff. Now, my own personal bet is that there is something of deep value to these ideas, because you can see how the real and the complex numbers, which are used absolutely every day by theoretical physics, that maybe they should be expanded to just be able to handle good old three-dimensional space, right from the start without having to do anything else. If that more complicated line is of deep value, then if I didn't present it, then some arbitrary number of years, somebody else would have figured out the same darn thing. As a matter of fact, this is something that is investigated time and time again. People run across these types of numbers and say, we should do more. That's been true since they were born back in, by Hamilton back in 1843. And every generation, one or two people says, hey, we should do more. And I'm just continuing that tradition. And this video will be of value to somebody who also thinks along those lines, whether those lines are true or not true. I also find the simplified story actually kind of fun too, because we've got these three different ways to represent the trivial group. 0 plus 0 equals 0, 0 times 0 is 0, and 1 times 1 is 1. And you say, yeah, but I don't get it. Don't worry. This is research in progress. You're not supposed to kind of get it. You're supposed to go either it feels like nothing, or it feels like a kernel of something. If I've gotten that far, that would be a very good thing. But physics, for some odd reason, is strange. And even that is strange, because generation after generation, we take the smartest of the smartest of the smartest of the smartest people and say, work on fundamental physics. And you go, but aren't you trying to explain sin, the simplest shit in nature? If you're explaining the simplest shit, it should be simple. Why do we need such smart people doing this? And now my perspective on that is that there's this wonderful tension between these three different types of ways of representing the trivial group. Because I'm the center of the universe, Mr. Zero, and you are too. I see you as a one, and you see me as a one. So who's right? Oh, neither. We have to somehow embrace all three of these groups as we all get older together by adding another zero, which didn't feel like it got older. It just kind of kept going, right? So I don't get it myself, but I feel like it's possible that this could be a reason why fundamental physics remains a deeply strange subject. All right, so what do I hope to accomplish? Do I hope that thousands of people are going to watch this video? The answer is no, because that's the track record I've got. I am not part of a physics community, and so I do this in my basement, and we see what happens, which is not a lot. But what I do is I sometimes focus on an aspect and say, that's not quite right, I'll just make a small improvement. And that's all I really did here, was I said, hey, I should think about zero and, you know, the two sets being right next to each other so we can think of the delta much easier. And the other big improvement was the directional zeros that went from unity or minus one to zero. I'd never heard that idea brought up, you know, coming up with the full graph theory for just multiplying real numbers or multiplying complex numbers. And it just feels like a richer way to understand numbers, which are absolutely central to what physicists actually do. So that's my goal. My goal is not to win over the world. Nope. It's just to make small steps forward so that if anybody else comes along and says, well, where should I start? I said, well, that's a good enough starting place. I'll take a few steps forward from there. All right. Thank you very much.